Hi, I'm Brian Holt, and I'm a product manager at Stripe. Welcome to the complete intro to computer science. By learning these data structures and algorithms, it will help you become a better coder. In this course, we will talk about how to calculate Big O, how to make trade-offs, how to sort numbers, data structures, AVL trees, binary search trees, tree traversals, graphs, pathfinding, and more. I hope you enjoy the course. So let's actually, I can even just copy and paste this. I'm gonna bring up my console here. And I'm gonna say function, and I'm actually gonna modify this to say current, because that's actually what I meant. And I say count to 10. What do you expect this to do? Oh, and I think I have to give it a 0 or a 1, something like that. What do you expect this to do?
Count to 10?
Yep, it's going to go count 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. Right? There's no for looping here, though. How did that work? Well, it calls count to, and then eventually it calls count to again, and it goes through this over and over again until it arrives at this case right here, if, and then it stops calling count to. So again, this is not a useful recursive function, but this is a recursive function in that it's a function that calls itself. Now, I imagine most of you can imagine a better way of writing this, right? A simple for loop, a for each, a map, any one of those things would have been clearer than this, you know, abomination of code right here. But I wanted to demonstrate to you just basically that you can make basically anything recursive if you really try hard enough. And if you've ever written code or in languages like Racket or Scheme or Lisp or any Lisp sort of oriented language, this is actually the only way of doing a for loop, which is with recursion. Definitely not a Scheme class. Though, I'll just toss out a recommendation. Not that I'm going to teach you how to write Scheme, but it made me a better programmer to go and learn a little bit of how to write Scheme. So, and it's a fun weekend project. It's because it's a pretty simple language. When is recursion useful? Well, when you find yourself in the definition of your problem, modeling it in terms of smaller versions of the same problem, that's a good indication that your problem could be solved recursively. So one of the classic examples that people like to talk about with recursion is something called the Fibonacci sequence. Now again, I don't want to veer too mathy here, but the idea of the Fibonacci sequence is the Fibonacci of 3 is the Fibonacci of 2 plus the Fibonacci of 1, right? And the definition of the Fibonacci of 100 is Fibonacci plus 99 plus the Fibonacci of 98 plus the Fibonacci of 97 plus the Fibonacci of 98. So on and so forth, that you can generalize as the Fibonacci of n is the Fibonacci of n minus 1 plus the Fibonacci of n minus 2, right? And what is the Fibonacci of n minus 1? Well, that's the Fibonacci of n minus 2 plus the Fibonacci of n minus 3, right? And you can kind of expand that out to eventually you arrive at what the Fibonacci of 2 is defined to be 1, and the Fibonacci of 1 is defined to be 1, and the Fibonacci of 0 is defined to be 0. Those are like kind of like the givens. So, as you might imagine, the Fibonacci of 3 is Fibonacci of 2 plus the Fibonacci of 1, so the Fibonacci of 3 is 2. The Fibonacci of 4 would be the Fibonacci of 3, which we just found out is 2, plus the Fibonacci of 2, which is 1, so that would be what did I just say? 3, 4. Anyway, it's kind of hard to keep all this in your head, right? So there are negative Fibonacci numbers. We're ignoring them. Please, for the sake of this course, we're just talking about positive Fibonacci numbers. So the first thing is when you're talking about recursion is always, always, always just define your base case first. The base case is when your recursion stops, right? Because if you don't ever stop your recursion, then you get stack overflows. So for example, up here in our count to, this if statement right here, is your base case. So if current is greater than max, then return, right? That's when we've decided, it's like, okay, we've satisfied all the conditions, we're now done, we're not recursing anymore. So this is our base case, that if n is equal to, we'll look at this one, equal to 2 or equal to 1, then return 1, otherwise return 0. So we have the n equals 2 or the n equals 1. Don't click on it. So the base case here is that we return 1, and if we somehow end up on 0, we shouldn't end up on 0. But if we did, then you return 0. Okay? And then we just define the Fibonacci in terms of what our definition was. So the Fibonacci of 5 is the return, the Fibonacci of 5 minus 1, which is 4, and 5 minus 2, which is 3, right? Which then calls this until eventually those arrive to their base cases, and then those return until eventually we kind of add all those numbers up, and we end up with the correct answer. So Fibonacci of 3, 2, right? That makes sense. So on and so forth. So we're going to talk about something called AVL trees, which is going to respond to that problem that we just had, that we have these kind of worst case scenarios where we have to go through 100 hops and 100 numbers. This is an AVL tree is the same as a BST, so every AVL tree is a BST. So that's one thing to keep in mind. Not all BSTs are AVLs. So an AVL tree is a specialized version of a binary search tree. And the good news here is you can add numbers in order and it will automatically balance out your tree for you. It has a self-balancing mechanism built into the tree. So AVL trees are not necessarily the best ones. In fact, I would venture to say that you'll never use AVL trees directly in production as well, but it's a really good, perhaps most simple self-balancing tree that we can talk about. If you're wondering what AVL stands for, it stands for the last names of the authors, which is Adelson, Velsky, and Landis, right? Hence AVL. Okay. So the nice thing about AVL trees is things mostly work the same. The deletes work the same, the adds work the same, the finds all work the same. All that stuff ends up being exactly the same except for one key part. So when you go down and you do an add, you'll actually perform what's called a balancing. And that's actually going to allow you to make sure they have a balanced tree. So let's take a look at this one here. I'll just make this full size so you can see. So we're going to add a number here. So the first thing you can do is you're going to do exactly like a BST. You're going to find where it should go. Okay, so we're going to add a child to the 8 here. Okay, so I added 9 here to the 8, right? So this is still a valid BST right now, right? Nothing here is a miss for a BST. However, this tree right here ends up being out of balance. This is much lower than, like, say, the 71 over here. So we want to do some sort of balancing to make sure that these lookups stay really fast. So what it's going to do is it's going to go up the tree and say, hey, is this leg balanced? Is this leg balanced? Is this leg balanced? It's going to land on the 7, and the 7 is out of balance. And the way we're going to define out of balance is the right child has 2 height difference from the left child, right? So the left child height of the 7 is 0, right? It has no left children, so it has no height on its left side. The right height, it has 8 and 9, right? So it has a right height of 2. So it's going to balance itself through what's called a rotation, okay? So let's kind of just step back through that. Right? So it's going to move 8 to be the root of this little subtree. It's going to make 7 the left subchild and 9 the right subchild. So you can see there, now it's balanced, and now everything is balanced. Right? And there you go. So that's called a single rotation. I think it's technically a left rotation. As you might imagine, you can rotate the other way right. So this, the right child is heavy. But as you may imagine, you can also have the left child be heavy, in which case we would rotate to the right. And that's it. That's the only difference here that we're really concerned about, is these rotations. Let's build a bloom filter. So the first thing we already built here was this array equals new array 100 fill. So we have an array of 100 things filled with zeros, right? So to do an add, really all we're going to do is this dot array, and then we're going to put our three hashing functions here, string equals 1, right? And actually, we're just going to do that three times for all of our three hashing functions. That's it. That's all you got to do to add something. So one big key thing that you know about bloom filters, we can't delete anything, right? Because how do you know what to delete and what has previously used it and what hasn't, right? There's no additional information here. So that's another kind of downfall of bloom filters, is that you cannot delete from a bloom filter. OK. Then here with the contains, all you're going to do is return. And I'm going to show you a little trick here. If you put a double exclamation point, this is going to coalesce it into a Boolean, right? So this is going to take whatever this comes back as a true or false. And I'm saying this.array, each one string, and then I'm going to do this like this, this one right here is going to be H2, and this one right here is going to be H3, just like that. So yeah, let's talk about, this is a little bit clever, but let's just walk through it. H1, so this is going to be either a 0 or a 1. This is going to be a 0 or a 1, and this is going to be a 0 or a 1, right? Zeros, if you do this, let's ignore that. That's not helpful. Make it a little bit bigger down here. If you look here in the bottom right, if I do 0 double equals false, that's true, right? Same with true double equals 1. So these things, if you're willing to do, what's the word I'm looking for? That is just escaping me, the term there. Anyway. If you're willing to convert it from a number to a Boolean, then you can do it this way with a double equal sign. So if I put exclamation point 0, that actually comes back as false, right? And if I put exclamation point 1, that comes back as true. So if I do exclamation point 0 and 0 and 0, that's false. But if any one of these is true, this comes back as, or actually if, right? So only if they all come back as one is it true. So now we should be able to run our tests here. Let's reset my zoom here, play. And if we go look at bloom filters, we got to not skip this. And click play. And did that work? No. Oh, these are all skipped. Let's do this. OK, one more time. Let's try it. Bloom filters, there we go. And if you click on that, you can see that it's returning false when empty, handles one item, handles many items. All that works super well. Okay, so you could have done this in a much less clever way and just said, like, if you know this.array h1 triple equals 1 and the h2 and the h3, all that kind of stuff, and that would have probably been more clear. But this seemed kind of terse and nice, so I went with that.